All right, so you'll probably spend a lot of time around the input section of your console, right? Because that's all of the band, all the vocals, all the headset mics, anything coming into you, that's all the inputs. You're receiving all the information, processing it, and turning it around to get to the outputs, right? So let's spend some time looking at the inputs, kind of the processing that we've deployed in the default show file, and then just kind of how you start an input, if you will. So we've seen the top four layers again. Those are your 64 inputs, and we're not using a lot of them. There's still a lot of expansion in this console. But let's look at the drum layer, for instance. All these plugins have Emo in front of them, and we've talked about how this is the Emotion LV1 mixer from Waves. And we talked about the F2, the Q4, the D5, what those mean. That's your high pass and low pass filter, your parametric EQ, and your 5-band dynamic suite. So we've tried to keep it simple, and we've tried to manage latency and core management as much as we can, trying to keep that as low. By using those Emo plugins, we're actually able to keep this machine running very efficiently and actually keep it very familiar. These are very familiar looking products to somebody who's been around like an X32 or an M32, any other console even, where you've got your filters, your EQ, your 5-band dynamic suite, and then even just kind of the layout. Here's your sends, here's your EQ, your dynamics, all that kind of in one place. And if we were in the mixer window and we wanted to look at channel, it's in there too. By utilizing the Emo plugins, we're able to get all that information and make it really accessible and familiar to somebody who maybe hasn't been around this tool, but it feels familiar in that way. We also have included some presets that are maybe a little more advanced, and they leverage some of the dynamic processing that we can get in dynamic EQ. There's some vintage compressors, there's some stacked compressors that allow us to kind of manage some things, limiting on our keys and hooks, and maybe kind of doing that to help kind of balance your overall mix balance that way that you haven't played with before. And allows you, by doing some virtual sound check stuff, you can kind of get in and kind of play with, like, what happens if I add this plugin? What happens if I take this one away? What happens if I adjust the threshold? You can learn about all those things, all right? So again, we've started you kind of as simply as possible, the Emo plugins, even on the guitars. There's nothing there because really, in our environments, we try to push all the processing back in the guitar player. I shouldn't be doing a lot of that back here as an engineer, because if I am, it's processing in their ears differently than the tone that they've been shaping and crafting as they've rehearsed throughout the week. We got our acoustic line. There's some built-in reverb on that. The keys lines have some compression, some stack compressors. Down to vocals, we've got some tuning in here. We've got some PSE, some primary source enhancers that allow you to actually kind of duck the mic and keep it out of the way. So when you've got a really loud stage, it can keep your levels from running out of control and getting into feedback. So you can play with all these things, you can read about them, and anytime if you want to learn about what a plugin does, you can hit this little, I guess it's a stack of three little lines in the upper right-hand corner of all the plugins, and hit user manual. As long as you're online, this actually brings up the manual on how to use this. Super helpful. Actually, this might even be offline. It looks like this is actually offline inside the program files directory. So that's super helpful that you don't have to be online to get at those. You can also get the Waves user manual by clicking on the W in the upper right-hand corner too. I'll just say that as long as we're on that topic right now. So back on inputs, if we look at like our drum inputs or any of these things, let's actually just like maybe go ahead and patch in an input right now. So let's jump into this channel and we can say input A, and then I can just choose what stage box it's in. I'll go ahead and grab this one. This one's online. And now I can hit my gain, and I can either do that right from my, up here. I can toggle that here. I can toggle that here. If it's selected, I can kind of move that back and forth. We've got my touch and turn knob. We learned about that in the Fit controller settings. Okay, there's a lot of different ways. If I move this utility button here, I've got gain control here on the Fit controller this way. You can get a gain about four different ways on any of these inputs. And really, the thing we talk about in AIMS all the time is source matters. And that can mean a variety of different things. But from a mixing engineer standpoint, it means getting the input gain high enough that really all of these preset dynamic thresholds will all start functioning as they're intended if you have enough input gain. If the input gain is coming in too anemically, nothing will trigger downstream. if it's too heavy, it's gonna start compressing it way over the top. So what we try to target is that negative 18 dB spot. And the reason why that number is important, this is just math. Negative 18 dB is really where 0 dB analog gain converts to kind of the electrical signal. So that's at negative 18. So we might run some signals hotter. We might run some signals right around that level, but we're trying to target that negative 18. You'll kind of see here my drums, they look like they're clipping. That's just the transient. This is kicks and snares. They have significant transients compared to that overall RMS signal. So that's the peak versus transient. If we looked more here on this page where this is all kind of rest of our band, everything's kind of hovering right around that negative 20, negative 10. So we're getting them in a really good spot there. There might be some peaks getting into yellow, but they're in that right spot to allow all of the compressors and the dynamic processing that was built in and designed within this tool to really to function correctly. So again, you got to get to the right level. Source matters. Getting to the right input level, that actually really does make a difference, which was delivered here in the default tile or default template. As we're looking at this negative 18 thing, I want to draw some attention here. These faders or this scale, this resolution on the scale is really different for me. I mix most oftenly on other consoles, and I don't spend as much time on LV1. But what I've learned is that I expect the green to go much farther up that meter indicator than it does here. So again, these are logarithmic, right? The nice thing that Waves has done is they've given us a tremendous amount of resolution. That negative 10 to positive 10 is half of the fader. So that's really unique here, I think, so, which is why it can kind of look like, well, my gain isn't high enough, I need to get it higher. Well, it's actually metering right fine. We're right around that negative 18 or higher in there. I've just got a lot of resolution. So that's really a nice, helpful thing that Waves has done for us. So that's a quick overview there. We're gonna jump in, we're gonna have another video on inputs that we'll talk about preset management, kind of best practices there for core management with these plugins. But let's stop there before we move on.